We're here at IAV 2019 and I'm speaking with Dominic Phoon, Project Director, Bronco ST Engineering. Dominic, Bronco has been around for a few years now, but could you give us a little bit of the history of the platform, when it was developed, why it was developed?
Oh, well, we started in 1996-97, where there was a local requirement for a bigger vehicle, because the local requirement was for the replacement of BV206s. And the BV206, as you know, is a much smaller vehicle than our Bronco vehicle here. So it was important to develop a newer capability in terms of greater payload, greater protection, greater ability for carrying of different type of roles, different type of variances. Yeah.
And when you say protection, what's the actual requirement from 1995-96? Did that actually specify protection within that original requirement?
I can't sort of divulge that, but for this type of vehicle, going forward, the requirements for many users requires protection level. So it's natural that you have to have protection for this vehicle.
And there have been three generations of Bronco, as I understand it. The original Bronco, the first Bronco, and you probably can't confirm this, was supplied to Singapore Armed Forces. The second generation Bronco, would that be what the UK MOD refers to as Warthog?
That is correct. In fact, we actually derived the Warthog from the Bronco one, we call it Bronco 2 actually, and it was in use in Afghanistan, where it actually performed tremendously well. It had about 30 more IED hits, but zero fatalities. So a great record for this vehicle actually.
And from Bronco 2, you obviously moved on to Bronco 3. Could you talk us through the technical differences between Bronco 1, Bronco 2, and the latest Bronco 3?
Right. So for the Bronco 1, when it started off, the protection requirement was not as stringent as that is required for the Afghanistan theater, whereby they are facing with IEDs, etc. So you require additional payload for cages, you know, for those bar armor. So in a way, when we went into Bronco 2 or the Warthog, we had to slap on a lot of weight until that the actual payload of the vehicle created a GVW, a gross vehicle weight of almost 21 tons. But we realized that for this vehicle to remain as an all-terrain track carrier, it could not remain at the 21-ton mark. So we did a sort of a exercise to re-engineer the vehicle to bring the weight saner down by about 2.5 tons, so that the vehicle that you see in front of you now has the same protection level as the Warthog, but the weight, or the gross vehicle weight of the Bronco 1.
And could you tell us some of the things that you've done to get the weight down?
Okay, very simple. I give you an example. For the structural stiffness that's within this vehicle, we actually decided to design it with dual use. So the idea, it is not just for the strengthening of the hull or for mine blast events, but we actually use it for ventilation. So the interior cavity of the stiffeners are used as a channel for hot air or for cool air to bring climate control to the crew that's seated within. So that's one example of optimizing on the weight. The other areas, of course, is we looked at the hull, the shaping of the hull. This hull is now a lot more simpler to build compared to our earlier Bronco 2 hull. So in terms of the number of plates that it uses is much less, but we still maintain the same load carrying capability as well as the volume and space.
And in terms of automotives, I would assume that they have evolved from the earlier Broncos. What's the automotive setup of Bronco 3?
The automotive setup of Bronco 3 is a bit different from 1 and 2 in the sense that we wanted a shorter power pack. Reason why is, from my experience in Afghanistan, we realized that most of the mine blast events occurred around the track area. So we wanted to seat the crew, the driver and the commander, in the center of the vehicle away from the track area. So in order to do that, we had to have the power pack much shorter. So we actually changed to a Mercedes engine instead of using the older Caterpillar C7 engine. And the Mercedes engine added another advantage to the vehicle's performance, because it's a higher torque engine. The performance in terms of off-road mobility is there. In terms of gradability, you have sustained speed. In terms of fuel consumption, it's a lot better than the previous engine configuration. Yeah.
And in terms of payload, what sort of payload does the vehicle have at what one might call its standard or base level of protection?
At the base level of protection, you're talking about a payload of almost six tons. Because this vehicle, technically speaking, can go up back up to the 21-ton mark of the Warthog, because the suspension and the running gear system are the same.
And is it amphibious in its standard configuration?
In the standard configuration, it is amphibious, but you would have to limit the gross vehicle weight to about 16.5 tons, which means that you have a payload of 4.5 tons, which is not bad. So in that format, you can swim without any added kits. But if you would like to swim at a higher tonnage, then of course this vehicle would need to carry additional swimming kits on the side of the vehicle to help float, because limitation of the volume and the space.
And you're showing it here in the UK, and one would assume that you've brought it here to signal intent for the emerging UK requirement for a vehicle of this type?
I can't really say right now, but we are definitely have interest in looking at this requirement if it comes out. But at the moment, we have not really decided how we will play with this new requirement. Yeah.
Excellent. Thank you very much indeed.